genre.
Hello and welcome back to Rocky Minute, the daily podcast where we analyze the movie Rocky 1 minute at a time. I'm Doug Greenberg.
And I'm Jason Haynes.
And fresh off of sharing a moment with a Nazi truck driver and then throwing him out is our pal Pete Mummert from the Indiana Jones Minute.
Hey, guys.
Hello, welcome back.
Just don't smile.
I know. That made that moment so much more awkward, didn't it?
It did.
Today we're knocking out minute 83, which begins with Rocky talking to Butkus and ends with persona non grata Paulie.
Mm-hmm.
Just to clear up, Pete doesn't hang out with Nazis. It was a reference to Raiders of the Lost Ark. You never know, Pete. You never know what people may think.
That's a good point, yeah.
So Rocky notices the news van and asks Butkus whose truck it is.
Obviously, it's WAUC-TV news truck. But man, have news trucks changed since the 70s.
Jesus. Oh, yeah.
Like you can see inside, there's nothing inside. There's no gadgets, no dishes, no nothing.
Well, that's because it's Philadelphia.
Somebody probably stole it.
Yeah, 70. Yeah, it's all gone.
It was there when they pulled up.
Sorry to our Philadelphia listeners.
And there's an archaic phone booth in the background there.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's cool.
Man, remember those things?
Yep.
Yep.
You wouldn't want to get in there if you're claustrophobic.
And they get hot, like if it's, yeah, it's a hot day out.
And right. And the door never closed and opened easily. It was always like something you had to shimmy fiddle something, yeah. Fiddle with,
yeah,
it.
Yeah, yeah. And it seemed like most of them were broken anyway. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Like most of them, there was like, there was no phone at the end of the handle, like at the end of the wire, or else something was always messed up.
Gum stuffed in the coin slot.
You put your, yeah, quarter in and it just comes flying right back out the coin return slot.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Yeah.
Public phones, man. You just don't see them anymore.
No.
Yeah, that's definitely a lost world.
We're dating ourselves for our younger listeners.
Well, also dating ourselves. I was curious about this no help wanted sign. Because I was a really little kid in the late 70s, but I remember that we were kind of coming off of a bad recession. Mm-hmm. And like we lived in a little town, and the big industry there was actually a meatpacking plant. And I remember that was tough times.
It looks like there's something scribbled down there in Spanish too.
Yeah, no hay trabajo, no work.
That's what it says, no work?
Yeah.
I know trabajo means work, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I thought it said no banjo.
No banjo?
You can't play banjo in there.
So it shows Paulie and Rocky walking outside, but didn't Rocky just walk in?
And where's Butkus right now?
Yeah, that's another question.
Oh, he's in heaven. He's just having his greatest meal of his life.
No, all the meat.
Yeah.
Just put him by the scrap pile and he's going to town. Paulie says, one call for me and you're a celebrity. He's desperately trying to wedge himself, mm-hmm, into Rocky's fame.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
And I like this little Freudian slip there. You got need exposure.
Yeah.
Like he starts off, he realizes Rocky already has exposure. And he's like, I mean, you need me to help you get exposure.
Was that a thing or did Burt Young trip on his line?
That's a good question. I don't know.
Call him up.
If it was written that way and he played it that way, that it was beautiful.
Yeah,
yeah. You think I would look, but I'm not.
Please don't. Last time it's the script.
But he leans right in Rocky's face before he says that you need exposure.
With his whiskey cigar breath.
Another thing is he really sells the drunk. He sells the drunk thing.
He might be drunk. I don't think he's selling it.
Rocky tells him, don't breathe on me.
With your ciggy breath.
I feel like I could smell him through the computer screen.
Yeah.
He just looks like
he's like dirty. He's been making meat all day. He's smoking cigars, drinking.
Yeah. Wearing all those. He's wearing a nice sports coat and then that meat coat over the top of it. That's got to just be. Is he a likable character?
No. We've touched on this here and there. He's not a likable character. No. No. Because the extent. We don't even see, we only see, what we see only scratches the surface of the abuse that he unleashes on Adrian.
Yeah.
You know, I hate to think that at some point down the line, there's even been some physical abuse. Maybe he's smacked her across the mouth.
Uh-huh. It's interesting, though, because there's something about him. It seems like the movie's almost trying to make you like him to a degree, though. And I wonder if that's just because Rocky sees something in him. Like, Rocky seems to like him.
Even after the spats they have.
Uh-huh.
Like, the first time he punches the meat, Paulie wants a crumb thrown his way. And Rocky says no. So Paulie lashes out. Rocky starts punching the meat. And then at the end of that, it was just like, all right, I'll see you tomorrow. You know, it's like they get to that point, they boil over, and then it's mm-hmm. like they're pals again.
Yeah, like right now, they're about to, you know, they argue and Rocky's mad, and then they're going to have like a fake fighting thing. Look at him, like a fake choking. I should kill you.
Yeah,
like, his hat.
Yeah, yeah. Now, what do you think their history is? Like, do you think they went to like high school together? How do you think these guys know each other?
Well, we know Adrian and Rocky are the same age. Paulie is a few years older than Adrian.
Oh, that's right. Okay.
Where do we land on it? They just know each other from the neighborhood?
Yeah, I think so.
Going to the same bar.
Yeah. Yeah.
I don't know about that. But Rocky, I don't know. We don't know.
We need a prequel story of how Rocky and Paulie met.
That's ours. We have dibs. I swear to God.
As if the prequel and the filling in the blanks thing hasn't been done to death by poor Star Wars franchise.
Yeah, you'll find that Mickey raised Butkus from a puppy. And like, it's all gonna be...
Everybody's connected somehow.
Yeah, right?
It's just this one little universe.
Yeah, Apollo Creed and Adrian went to grade school together.
Yeah, of course.
A Rocky prequel. Interesting.
Rocky's not happy about Paulie calling the news. So, you know, this is supposed to be done in private. Paulie says they want to watch you train. But he goes, they want to watch you train. Boom. And he kind of punches Rocky a little playful way. But there's more than once Rocky kind of waves away the stink breath that
mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah.
Paulie has.
Is Paulie actually trying to do him a favor?
No.
Or is Paulie he's just out for himself?
He's out for himself.
Yeah.
This is all set up, you know, to come there. I mean, the meat punching is not even a thing. He did it one time. Like, it's not how he trained.
Right.
So Paulie set this whole thing up to get people to come. And he even says, like, when they go inside and he says to the reporter, he introduces her to Rocky and he goes, what about me? And she goes, what about you?
I like that.
And he goes, I'm in charge of the meat.
Rocky tells him, you're not doing me no favors. You're embarrassing me in front of everybody. You're making me look bad in front of your sister, which we know that's the big no-no.
That's fascinating to me though. Like, cause it doesn't seem like she's got a lot of, he's got a lot of competition.
Right.
Unless he's worried that now that she's come out of her shell, it's all of a sudden, oh, now I got to kind of make sure she stays into me. But it's, I think that really speaks highly of Rocky that, you know, he's kind of all she has and he's still worried about looking bad mm-hmm. in front of her.
You know, it's funny that you just mentioned that because before earlier when he was telling her how great she looked, she's going to be a heartbreaker. I kind of got a little sense of like, you look too good to be mm-hmm. out on the street by yourself.
Uh-huh.
You know, like just a small hint of jealousy. Not that it's in Rocky's nature to be uh-huh. jealous, but I detected a hint, small hint.
Uh-huh. Yeah, maybe he's worried that she's kind of already kind of leapfrogging past him.
Well, he knows that she could do better than him. I believe that in his heart, he thinks that.
Uh-huh.
So he's got to keep her around.
We all think that.
That our girls can do better than us?
No, the agent is better than Rocky.
Oh. Well, Paulie's mannerisms, like he'll take a drink from the bottle and then like sticks his tongue out like, oh man, that one burnt, you know, the hands waving. He takes his hat off and puts it in front of Rocky's face.
Yeah.
What the hell is he doing? He gets right in Rocky's face and goes, my sister really likes you. And then he starts like a drunk, maniacal laugh. He plays a great drunk, man. Mm-hmm.
He does.
Yeah. Yeah. And that's funny because that's like the magic words. Like that's how he disarms Rocky. Ah, my sister likes you. Like he can do anything to Rocky and then just end it with, hey, my sister really likes you and everything's cool.
And that's it. That's all he needs to hear.
That's it.
He got him laughing.
Yeah. Is it only Adrian that keeps Rocky around? Or do you think if Adrian weren't in the picture, do you think he really would have punched Paulie right here?
No, because no, I don't think so.
He's overall too nice of a guy.
Yeah.
And yeah. Yeah.
Like we touched on before, that in the end, they are pals.
Yeah.
He tells me he should have called me and left a message.
He doesn't have a phone. Right. You don't know that, right? Like, wait, left a message on what? Were answer machines out in the 70s?
I don't know.
No, just I don't look think it up. So.
But he should have called me and left a message.
On what? He told Adrian he doesn't have a phone.
Maybe he calls like the phone down in the hallway downstairs and the landlady answers or something.
The answer machine was invented in 1898. When were phones invented?
1897.
Jesus. They've been around since 1898. I didn't get one to like 1994. Where were all my messages prior to 1898 until 1994? Where are my messages? So many girls' dates I probably missed because they left a message and I never got it.
Back in 1899. Oh, man.
Oberlin Smith invented the answer machine. Wow.
Well, didn't Rocky say the reason he got rid of his phone is all those people were calling and leaving messages?
Yeah, too many people calling, interrupting him. His logic just doesn't make any sense ever. Paulie seems like he wants to be the one who puts Rocky on the map. You know, he has to get in on the action. I think it's totally self-serving.
Yeah. So you don't think there's a little germ of goodness in Paulie's heart? Like,
I think everything that he's done has been self-serving.
Yes.
Setting up the date with Adrian was kind of like, I gave you my sister. Now you have to put me in touch with Gazzo.
Yeah, that's true.
Yeah. You know, so yes, before if Paulie's a likable character, I said no, and I'll maintain that. Mm-hmm. At least in this movie, he becomes a likable character later on down the road.
Yeah. Yeah. I'm curious about the whole Gazzo thing though. Like, does he just think it'll be a better job working for a gangster, or does he just really hate working with meat, or is he like, oh, this is my chance to really get ahead in the world?
I'm not sure that it's getting ahead working for Gazzo. I think he wants to get out of the meat, but I think he also kind of gets a kick out of roughing people up.
Yeah, he wants the respect. He wants
Yeah. Like, he wants to be known on the street as the enforcer. Although I don't see how he could be.
You look at the guy and you're like, this guy's not intimidating at all. Maybe that's a secret weapon though.
Yeah, maybe. Maybe. But he's got the arthritis hands from working in the meat locker. How much damage can he do? What are you looking at me?
What are you guys talking about? I was reading the history of answer machines this whole time. I don't even know what you guys are talking about.
You have 80
feet. I'm amazed. Like, answer machines were like in the 1930s and 40s were in people's houses.
Wow.
In 1949, the first commercial answer machine, Tel Magnet, was offered in the United States for $200.
200?
You know how much time, like, you know when you were a kid and you like were waiting for a girl to call, you sat home all night, like you didn't leave the house, you didn't leave the phone, you kept checking to make sure it was working.
Yeah. You like yell at your sister for getting on the phone for two seconds. Right. Yeah.
And you're sitting there and you wait like 10 minutes, you pick up the phone and my brother was on and I'm like, wait for a call. And then I'm like, I could have just got an answering machine and went on with my life.
You know, you'd still be waiting by the phone.
Yeah, you'd be, this damn answer machine doesn't work. You'd be like smacking the tape against the wall.
You go down the block, call your answer machine to make sure it works.
But you got to keep going because the phone's missing from down the block.
That's right. There's gum stuck in the coin hole. Oh, man.
If any girls are listening who tried to call me back in grammar school and I didn't pick up or the phone was busy, try again. I have voicemail now. So go ahead. Back to what are you guys talking about?
We're talking about the news lady and cameraman in the meat locker.
Okay. What about
them? And Paulie loudly introduces Rocky as the next heavyweight champion in the world. He's not wrong. He's not wrong. Not this movie. But he's not wrong. That news lady is Diana Lewis.
WAUC-TV is not. I looked it up. I couldn't find anything. That's not a station.
Not a real thing.
No, not a real one. I looked it up too. Mm. Diana Lewis is a real news lady, though.
She sure was.
Tell us.
Like a big time.
Diana Lewis.
What do you got on Diana Lewis, Pete?
She worked, like, I saw she was an anchor in Philadelphia, LA, and Detroit. And I think Sylvester Stallone saw her on the news in LA and was like, oh, she's fantastic.
She held boats in place.
KABC in Los Angeles at the time this was filmed.
I like the 70s fur coat, man. That's a good look.
Yeah, that's awesome.
Sylvester Stallone felt that having a real reporter better than an actor acting as a reporter was the way to go.
They have to pair?
Yeah, they got a pair. But a real reporter has a distinct speech pattern, inflection mm-hmm. when they speak, and body language. And he said it's just you can't – it's hard to teach an actor that. It's just easier to have a news reporter act. And she has – I'm sorry, go ahead.
Oh, no, go ahead.
She has 13 acting credits, and they're all news reporters or anchor woman credits. Movies. Huh? Movies and TV, yeah.
I think her line where Paulie says he's in charge of the meat, and she says, "Fine, will you stand behind it, please?" Like that is one of the funniest lines in any movie I've ever seen. And she delivers it beautifully.
Not only that, if you watch it like the 58th second, right before the minute ends, she like when she says that, she like shoves him back and he like stumbles into the meat.
If you look when Burt Young, when Paulie and Rocky walk in, from that moment on, they don't show the front of Paulie. Hmm. Mm-hmm. When they walk in, you see when they first walk in, you kind of see the front of his meat coat swings open a little bit, and the front of it is burned. You get a quick glimpse of it. Burt Young hung up his hat and his meat packing coat in his trailer in between takes, and it was hanging right over the heater, and the thing caught on fire.
Oh.
So he didn't realize the heater was there. He hung up the thing. They caught on fire, but just the front got burned. And this was like a shoestring budget film, so they didn't have any extra. So it was Burt Young's idea to kind of like duck behind the meat so they couldn't get the
Oh, nice.
So trying to get into the shot to cover up the fact that he burnt his clothes. But like I said, when they first walk in, not here you know looks fine.
That's one of those things you guys were talking about when Jerry was on, though. Like, it's one of those things it's hard to eat. Like, you don't even realize that wasn't completely intentional by the filmmakers because it plays so perfectly that he's hiding behind the meat.
Yeah, it's crazy how stuff like that works out. But it's stuff like that lends itself to the movie that you appreciate so much more.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Because I love this. This is one of the most memorable things when she tells him to scram.
Yeah, I saw it.
Yeah, yeah. And I love how he kind of does kind of duck behind the meat.
Yeah. So, so I borrowed that from Tomorrow's Minute, so forgive me, people.
Okay. What are you going to do tomorrow?
That's it. That was my only note for tomorrow.
Okay.
All right. I mean, that's the end of the minute here.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So I heard there's this thing on the internet called Indiana Jones Minute.
Yeah, you heard correct.
Oh, wow.
we do exactly what you guys do, but with Indiana Jones.
And it's an incredible show that everybody please go check out. Because Pete and Jerry, who we had on a couple weeks ago, and Tom, who wouldn't return my phone calls.
He doesn't return anybody's phone calls.
Oh, it's not just me then. I was starting to get self-conscious. It's not just you. I was checking my answering machine. Making sure my answering machine worked. Everybody go check that out. They did Raiders, which was great. Temple of Doom, which they had a hilarious take on, because all three of them know it's kind of a garbage film, but you know, they love it for what it is. Am I correct?
Well, two of us thought that.
So you actually like it.
I actually liked it, surprisingly. Yeah. But it's always hard to tell how much I really loved a film and how much was a knee-jerk reaction to Tom and Jerry saying lots of negative things about a movie I loved from my childhood.
And who was more negative on it?
Oh, Jerry by far.
Jerry.
Yeah. Yeah.
All right. So everybody go check it out. They're going to release Last Crusade Minute, which when is that slated to release?
Sometime early next year. We don't have an exact date yet.
Well, these minutes are airing early in 2018, so they might be out.
Sometime early this year. Yeah.
Yeah. All right. We are Rocky Minute on Twitter. Our Facebook listeners page is Mighty Mix. And DuelingGenre.com is our little home away from home where all of our stuff is released. So go check it out. Now we continue with Diana Lewis and the meat punching on the next Rocky Minute.